لله الحمد لله الحمد لله وكفى وسلام على عباده الذين اصطفى الحمد لله الأول بلا بداية الحمد لله الباقي بلا نهاية الحمد لله الذي دنا في علوه وعلى في دنوه الحمد لله الذي لا تبلغه الأوهام ولا تحيط به العقول ولا الأفهام وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدًا عبد الله ورسوله وصفيه من خلقه وحبيبه بلغ رسالة وأدى الأمانة ونصح الأمة وكشف الغمة وجاهد في الله حق الجهاد حتى أتاه اليقين اللهم صل وسلم وزد وبارك على المبعوث رحمة للعالمين وسيد الخلق أجمعين محمد الصادق الوعد الأمين وعلى آله وأصحابه وأتباعه ومن اهتدى بهديه وعمل بسنته إلى يوم الدين وارض عنا معهم بفضلك وكرمك أرحم الراحمين اللهم آمين. I praise Allah سبحانه وتعالى and I thank Him for the blessings that He has bestowed upon me and my family and loved ones. I thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, endless He is in His glory, and I express my gratitude to the Lord in words and action. I say alhamdulillah, alhamdulillah, alhamdulillah with every breath I take, with every beat of my heart, and with every step I take on this earth. I thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the endless blessings that He has granted me. I bear witness that there is no deity in this universe worthy of worship save Allah. And I bear witness that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is Allah's final prophet and messenger, the bearer of glad tidings, the carrier of the torch of light, the role model to be followed sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. May the peace and blessings of Allah be upon him and his family and his companions, his followers and students and all men and women that walk steadily in the footsteps of Muhammad. And I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make each and every one of us among them. Allahumma ameen. My dear brothers and sisters, I greet you the greeting of Islam. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Just a few weeks left before the month of Ramadan starts. And as I promised before, I will attempt to give you a quick reminder, inshallah ta'ala, a short loving reminder to prepare for Ramadan so that we're not wasting any time before the beautiful month actually comes upon us. We are in the month of Rajab. And a part of the process of getting ready for Ramadan is to understand the meaning of Rajab and the meaning of Sha'ban and why those months are right there before Ramadan leading up to this great and blessed month. Rajbu min al-ta'zim, as the Arabs used to say. When I lend greatness to something, when I assume something is sacred and holy and great and revered and respected, that in the language of the Arabs is called Rajb. So Rajaba is to lend greatness. And many scholars say that because the month of Rajab is the process by which the blessings of Ramadan come upon us, it lends greatness to that path. The 30 days of Rajab, they lend greatness and sanctity to the path by which we reach the month of Ramadan. As the Prophet taught us, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, I pray and I say, Allahumma balighna Ramadan. Allahumma balighna Ramadan. Allahumma balighna Ramadan. A'waman ba'da a'wamin waghfir lana fihi ya arhamar rahimin. I pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us a chance to live until we witness the month of Ramadan and to be among those who are forgiven in Ramadan. One of the difficulties that we face when Ramadan comes is that our hearts are not prepared for the month. Our hearts are still consumed with the day-to-day challenges. So it takes so much time when Ramadan actually starts to get in the mood of Ramadan and the system of Ramadan. And I wanted to tackle just one issue today, inshallah. And that is a universal phenomenon that all Muslims, all people of faith experience. And that is what the scholars call Zahiratul Da'f al-Iman. The weakness of your faith. The weakness of your Iman. You ask some Muslims about it, sometimes they'll say, I'm so connected to Allah, I'm so connected to the Quran, I listen to the Adhan, I have tears in my eyes, I'm so into the deen. And other times you're so completely disconnected, there's no khutba or khatira or reminder that will move your heart. Your heart hardens like a rock. And then a few months later, you're going into another phase. Your heart softens up and becomes tender again, and you're getting closer to the deen. And then you're happy and satisfied. And then you gradually, your heart hardens up again, and it becomes as hard as a rock. And then you don't understand why, and you're so confused, and then you feel like there's something wrong with you. Well, there was a sahabi of the Prophet ﷺ that experienced the same exact thing. If you know math, you have the x-axis and the y-axis, right? And then there is this wave that goes like this. You know what they call that? They call it the sine wave. Sometimes it goes up and sometimes it goes down. This is exactly how Iman is. Prophet taught us, Al-Iman wa yazid wa yanqus. Your faith gets stronger and gets weaker over time. How strong and how weak is up to you and your activities, and your day-to-day activities, and how your heart is. And let me tell you what this man said to the Prophet ﷺ. His name was Hamdala, and I'm sure many of you heard this story before. Hamdala once met Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, and he was so distressed. He was so upset. Tears in his eyes. Ya Hamdala, what is wrong with you? Hamdala al-Katib. He was from the tribe of Tamim, Hamdala al-Tamimi. But they used to call him Hamdala al-Katib, the scribe, because his handwriting, his penmanship was so beautiful. They used to call him Hamdala al-Katib, right? He was a sophisticated man, but not a sahabi that we've heard of on a regular basis. He's not well known. He meets Abu Bakr and he's so distressed. Abu Bakr as-Siddiq inquires and he asks him, "Maza bika ya Hamdala? What is wrong with you?" He says, "Ya Abu Bakr, nafaqa Hamdala. I think I'm a hypocrite. I have committed an act of hypocrisy." Abu Bakr as-Siddiq asks him, "What is wrong? What have you done?" He says to him, "عندما نكون عند رسول الله نسمع آيات القرآن والجنة والنار." When I'm with the Prophet ﷺ, my heart is floating up on the clouds, and I'm listening to the beautiful reminders, and I feel like I'm so connected. And he reminds us of heaven and hell, and all the things that I need to be straight on my path. But when I leave the Prophet's presence and I come home and I spend time with my family and my children and I get busy with my life, I feel that my heart hardens again. I'm a hypocrite. Abu Bakr as-Siddiq scratched the back of his head and thought about this, and he says to Hamdala, "Wallahi, inni la ara ma ra'ayt. I see exact same thing that you see in me. I experience the same thing. Why don't we go together to the Messenger ﷺ and ask him about this?" So they come to the Prophet ﷺ and tell him, "Ya Rasulullah, our iman keeps shaking and it keeps fluctuating and we don't know what to do. Are we just a bunch of hypocrites?" Again, mind you, brothers and sisters, that is Abu Bakr as-Siddiq himself, the Prophet's best friend and confidant. So the Prophet ﷺ smiles and he shakes his head and he says to them, "Wallahi, لو أنكم كما تكونون عندي لصافحتكم الملائكة في الطرقات." If you stay in your iman as strong as you are when you are with me, you will be in such a pure state that the angels will reveal themselves to you and will shake your hands while you're walking the streets. In other words, he's saying it's impossible. If you're so pure and sacred and blessed and maintaining the same strong level of iman, the angels will shake your hands. وَلَكِنْ سَاعَةٌ وَسَاعَةٌ. Sometimes it's going to be like this, and sometimes it's going to be like that, and you just need to deal with it and be as strong as possible. ضَعْفُ الْإِيمَانِ. The weakness of iman is an illness, is a secret killer of the heart. Because your sine wave may be going like this, goes up and it goes down, or the trend may be on the decline, it's going like this. And your heart is dying, and you keep deteriorating over time, and the quality of your faith keeps degrading over time, and you don't even see it, right? And this is a message to myself, first and foremost, to young and old in this crowd. I pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that this message will make a difference in terms of our preparedness for the month of Ramadan. I wanted to talk to you today about two things when it comes to the weakness of faith. Number one, how do I know that my faith is deteriorating? How do I know that my faith is degrading? What are the symptoms? Because some people might be like, "Well, you know, I pray and I come to the masjid. I don't say bad words. I don't say haram things. I'm good. What are you talking about? My faith is perfectly fine." That's a worse state of affairs, when you don't know that it's happening to you. When the cancer is taking over your entire being and you don't know that it's there. At least if I know, I will do something about it, but if I don't know, I'm just letting cancer eat me alive. Right? So I need to know what the signs and the symptoms are. And number two, just give you some simple advice about steps to take in order to maintain your heart and to maintain your iman in the days leading up to Ramadan. So that your curve is not going down like this, at least it stays steady. Up, down, up, down, up, down, and perhaps even inshallah ta'ala, the up, down, the trend of your curve is growing and not degrading, right? How do I know that my faith is getting weaker and weaker and weaker? The first and most important is how your heart responds and reacts to the Qur'an. How is it that your heart reacts to the Qur'an? The Prophet ﷺ once asked Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu to recite the Qur'an. And I told you about Abdullah before. He was extremely short. In modern day terms, Abdullah could actually be considered a dwarf. He was severely disabled. But he was such a loving companion of the Prophet ﷺ that he elevated him. And he was one of the greatest scholars of the Ummah at his time. He asked, but one of the qualities of Ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu is that his voice in the Qur'an was so beautiful. So the Messenger ﷺ asked him to recite the Qur'an. Ya Abdullah, iqra alayna min kitabillah. Recite from the book of Allah. Abdullah asked, Messenger of Allah. I mean, if you live at the Prophet's time, who is the one person on this earth that you'd rather hear the Qur'an being recited from? Sheikh Mishari? If you live at the Prophet's time, you would want to listen to the Prophet ﷺ himself recite the Qur'an, right? Naturally. So Abdullah tells him, Ya Rasulullah, أتلو القرآن وعليك أنزل. You want me to recite and you're here and it was revealed to you, Messenger of Allah. He says, Ya Abdullah, I love to listen to the Qur'an from your mouth because your voice is so beautiful. So Abdullah ibn Mas'ud starts reciting from the Qur'an and reciting from the Qur'an until he comes to this ayah. فَكَيْفَ إِذَا جِئْنَا مِنْ كُلِّ أُمَّةٍ بِشَهِيدٍ وَجِئْنَا بِكَ عَلَى هَؤُلَاءِ شَهِيدًا. Allah says to the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, how will it be on the Day of Judgment when I bring forth from every nation a witness to stand, to testify against them, and I bring you, Ya Muhammad, I bring you as a witness to testify with regard to the affairs of all the nations on this earth. The weighty responsibility of him testifying before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with regard to the affairs of every nation. And the Prophet asked him to stop. And he broke to tears, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. When was the last time you broke to tears just listening to the recitation of the Qur'an? And don't tell me if I understood the Qur'an, inshallah, I will react to the Qur'an. Most people who understand the Qur'an, their hearts are dead with regard to the Qur'an. And many people who don't understand the Qur'an, they shed tears by just listening to the Qur'an. How does your heart react to the Qur'an? This emotional, and again, I emphasize, this emotional response to the Qur'an isn't there. Some of us think that it's all about the rational, logical response to the Qur'an. It is also about the emotions. This is how you gauge your heart. Is your heart alive or dead? This is how you gauge the weakness of your iman or the strength of your iman. Am I responding to the Qur'an when I listen to the Qur'an, it moves me or not? You don't have to cry every single time, but does it move you? When you listen to your favorite reciter, do you say to yourself, MashaAllah, this is just so beautiful? When you're driving your car and you're listening to the Qur'an, are you moved when you listen to the Qur'an? Umar ibn Abdul Aziz radiallahu anhu was once leading people in prayer in Salatul Maghrib. And then he came across the ayah from Surah Al-Layl that many of us memorize. فَأَنذَرْتُكُمْ نَارًا تَلَظَّى. Allah warns, I warned you of a blazing fire. And Umar ibn Abdul Aziz could not read the next ayah. So he says, فَأَنذَرْتُكُمْ نَارًا تَلَظَّى, and he stops and he stutters. And he tries to recite, but his crying and his tears overtook him. And he couldn't, imagine that. So he's leading Maghrib and he has to go into Rukua because he couldn't finish that surah. Surah Al-Layl, which is a very short surah. When you read the Qur'an, I mean, I guess I should ask, when was the last time you opened the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and started reading from it in order to build some type of an emotional response, an emotional connection with the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Young and old, Don't tell me I am young and I'm having fun with my life and I'm enjoying my life right now. I will start focusing on the Quran when I go to college, when I get married, when I start my family. Don't tell me that. It starts right now. When you're a kid, if you're a kid. It starts right now. If you look at other people in this society and how they are and you're scared of becoming like one of them, then it has to start right now, building that emotional connection with the Quran. We respond a lot more effectively to emotion than rationality, right? We respond a lot more effectively to emotions. Build the emotions with the Quran, right? Every time the Quran said, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, O you who believe, you know what the companions used to do? They would be like at the marketplace or talking to each other or sitting at the masjid chatting. But whenever the Prophet said, O you who believe, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, you know what they did? They turn their faces and they give the Prophet their fullest attention. Why? Because they think that Allah is talking to them. Are you a believer? Yes. Well, Allah is trying to get your attention. O you who believe, yes, Lord. What? What can I do? If I said right now, all the Pakistanis, raise your hands, I will have your attention. Everyone's going to go, most people are going to go like this. All the Tunisians, raise your hands. The Egyptians, raise. If you're a Muslim, raise your hand. Right? If I do this, every single person in this room will raise, and I will have your attention. Oh my goodness, the Imam is about to make a statement right now. Now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells you in the Quran repeatedly, time and time again, O you who believe. Why don't I turn my face to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and say, Ya Allah, what do I need to do? You're talking to me now. You give me what do I need to do, Lord? Right? You need to learn how to respond to the Quran and how to react to the Quran. And if you're not reacting to the Quran, then that's a sign of illness right there. A sign of weakness in the heart, right? That's number one. Number two, the scholars taught us that one of the most common signs that there is a weakness of faith in your heart is that you are so easy to commit sins. And let me make a distinction. I'm not talking about major sins. I'm not talking about theft and murder and drinking alcohol. I'm not talking about the big things. I'm talking about the small ones. The ones that we keep justifying to ourselves, it's just a small sin, no big deal. Allah is all forgiving, Allah loves me, right? The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, al-Habib alayhi wa sallam, what does he say? He says, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, إِيَّاكُمْ وَمُحَقِّرَاتِ الذُّنُوبِ. Beware of the small sins. فَإِنَّهُنَّ يَجْتَمِعْنَ عَلَى الْمَرْءِ حَتَّى يُهْلِكَنَّ. They will keep piling up over your head until they destroy you. Let me show you how that works. If I told you right now, here's a boulder hanging by a rope. It's a one-ton boulder. How many of you would dare walking under the boulder? He's a risk taker right there. Most of us are not going to do this. Why? Because it's so risky. If the boulder fell, if it tore the rope and fell over your head, it'll crush you. Right? Now, if I took this boulder and I broke it down to small pebbles, each pebble is 1 gram, whatever it is, and I take this pebble and I put it on your head, how would you react? That's nothing, I can handle this. And then I add another pebble. What's the difference? No big deal. Iman, what are you trying to get to? What if I put 10 pebbles or 25 pebbles? Now the weight, now you can start feeling the weight over your head, right? What if I keep adding pebbles one after the other until I put all 1 ton worth of pebbles over your head? Do you think that it would be any different outcome than the boulder falling over your head? See? But it's much easier for me to accept the pebbles because it's a very gradual process. If someone offers you alcohol or drugs, astaghfirullah, I'm Muslim, I cannot do that. But when it comes to lying, when it comes to lack of trustworthiness or manifestations of arrogance, when you judge other people, when you miss on your salah here and there, when you're not connected to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this gradual process is much easier. Remember the experiment from, you know, the ages of old, when they used to, you know, put a frog in boiling water? You know that experiment? If you boil water and you throw the frog in the water, what's going to happen to the frog? No, it's not going to die. The frog is going to sense the heat and jump right away.
It may get burned a little bit, but it is not going to die. Now, what they did is that they put the frog in cold water. And they put that cold water on a very, very small flame. So it takes hours and hours and hours for the water to heat up. And they put the frog when it's still cold. You know what's going to happen? The frog will continue to stay in that environment until the water boils and the frog dies. Why? Because the change is extremely, extremely gradual. One tiny little sin after the other, and you think it's okay, it's okay, it's okay. The Prophet says, beware of those small sins because they are more likely to destroy you than the big ones. The big ones are way too obvious. You can tell when you see them right away. Number three, how do I gauge the weakness of my iman? When I read the news about the ummah and I do not react. I do not care. It doesn't bother me anymore. When you hear about bombings in Iraq and in Syria, they just, you know, the mighty US government just dropped this, you know, the largest bomb, non-nuclear bomb known to man, right? In Afghanistan, right? How many people did it kill? How many lives were lost? How many terrorists were created in the process is yet to be known. How do we react to news like this? I hear about this like 10 times a day. What's the big deal? This is the world we live in, man. It's messed up. Go back to your video games. The Prophet says, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, من لم يهتم بأمور المسلمين فليس منهم. If you are not concerned about the affairs of the ummah, and the problems and the challenges of, if it doesn't wake you up at night, you don't belong to this ummah, you don't belong to the Muslims. It's a matter of faith. You need to be concerned about what is happening in Palestine, what is happening in Yemen, what is happening in Iraq and Syria, what is happening in Kashmir. You need to be concerned about what is happening in our Muslim communities right here at home. Oh, if it's black Muslims, I don't care that much. But if it's an immigrant, if it's Pakistani Muslim or an Arab Muslim, it becomes important. See, if it's a poor Muslim, it's not important to me. But if it's a wealthy Muslim, it becomes important to me. Right? When the police beat up a Muslim that happens to be a doctor, oh, that becomes an issue. But if the police beats up a simple African-American Muslim, that is not an issue. How do you react to the challenges that the ummah is facing today determines your faith. And again, if you are like me and you're interested in knowing how strong your iman is, ask yourself, how do I respond to the challenges of the ummah? Am I concerned about what is happening to my ummah? Next point, which is just as important. We gradually become complacent about sin and filth. You say to one of those teenagers, they're listening to horrible, horrible music. And I'm not talking about the music per se. I'm not talking about the tunes. I'm talking about the lyrics. How could you allow yourself to fill your soul with this filth? He's like, Imam, come on, it's not a big deal. I really don't care about the words. I'm not paying attention to the words. I'm just enjoying the tunes. I'm enjoying the music. It's okay. My kid's school principal keeps playing, you know, music of very popular singers every morning. He's trying to be nice and funny and friendly to the children. But you know what happens? They start researching those singers when they go home. And while the lyrics or the songs that he shared with them, that he had them listen to, may have been filtered, you know, guess what? They're going to go home and they're going to do research about these things and they're going to realize, they're going to fall in love with that singer and everything they do and everything they produce, right? We become complacent and we refuse to change society around us. That is a sign of a very weak iman and a very weak state of heart, right? Because as Allah taught us in the Quran, كُنْتُمْ خَيْرَ أُمَّةٍ أُخْرِجَتْ لِلنَّاسِ. We are presumably the best nation brought to mankind, as the Quran says, on one condition. What is that? As everyone says, تَأْمُرُونَ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَتَنْهَوْنَ عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ. You enjoin what is right and you forbid what is wrong. Okay, how is that manifested today? How do we do that today? Exactly. Teenagers, college students, how do we do that today? This is such a hefty thing. The imams and the leaders will take care of that. I'm just a simple Muslim. What do I do in order to enjoin what is right and forbid what is wrong? Well, engaging people in your society. Telling people that you're Muslim. Being strong about your identity. Not rubbing it in people's faces, but be strong. I have never seen a Jewish stand-up comedian that did not go on stage and crack the joke about his Jewish identity. Never, not once. I have never seen a Latino actor or actress or stand-up comedian that would not put a little plug about who they are. We as Muslims, on the other hand, sometimes we try to find a way to hide who we are. And when we hide who we are, we have no impact whatsoever on society around us. And people don't take us seriously. And we become nothing to them. We become unimportant and irrelevant to them. But if you are strong about who you are and your identity as a Muslim, carry it with honor and pride. And walk around with it, not to tease people or hurt them or to establish your superiority. I just want people to know who I am. I'm Muslim, and that is that. And you better accept me as I am, or you're not my friend, and I don't really care about you. You know, in Arab culture, they have the Chronicles of Juha. Did you guys hear about those before? Funny stories about this fictional character. His name is Juha. And one of the things that Juha is very, very silly and foolish. Exemplifies most of us, right? And in the stories of Juha, it always tells the mistakes that we make. And one of the stories of Juha, they tell him, hey, oh my goodness, Juha, there is a big fire in the marketplace, about 2 miles away from your house. And Juha says, yeah, what do I hear? Juha, the fire actually reached the block close to your house.
Yeah,
it's not my block. Juha, the fire is now burning the house next door.
Who cares?
My house is still intact. Juha, the fire is now reaching your doorstep. I live in the second floor. Juha, it's burning the staircase. It's coming into your living room. Hey, my bedroom is really vast. You should see my bedroom. It's beautiful. And then he goes into the closet, and the fire is now burning his own bedroom, and he's just sitting in the closet. What do you think is going to happen next? If you do not negotiate with society around you and prevent evil from spreading, well, guess what? Evil is going to spread like fire, burning straws. This is, in my judgment, this is the definition of amr ma'ruf and nahi an munkar, enjoining what is right and forbidding what is wrong. Negotiate the institutions of society. From, you know, middle school and high school students who are observing their schools and their teachers and the administration, and they report anything. They report bullying. They report profanity. They talk to their parents about improving the school. To college students that are making da'wah, to adults in society that are engaging their local institutions, their city council, understanding what is on the ballot measures. How do I vote and why do I vote? Engaging that society so that there's a renewable process of change, fixing society. Fifth, and hopefully last but not least, in terms of the signs and symptoms of the weakness of Iman, to gauge our hearts, inshallah ta'ala, early enough before Ramadan, is what the scholars taught us, التثاقل في أمور العبادة. You feel like you're dragging your feet when it comes to matters of worship. You drag your feet. Oh my God, I have to pray Dhuhr again. Oh my goodness, I need to interrupt this and go pray. Can I do this later? Oh my God, I'm at school, I'm at work, I'm so busy right now, do I really have to interrupt all this and go pray? So, ibadah, acts of worship, feel like a chore, like such a heavy burden. And some people right now, they're having anxiety attacks because Ramadan is coming. They're having anxiety attacks. They wake up in panic at night. Long days, long hours of fasting, hunger, thirst, oh my God, it's going to be torture. See? يا أيها الذين آمنوا ما لكم إذا قيل لكم انفروا في سبيل الله اثقلتم إلى الأرض. O you who believe, when you are asked by God Himself to rise and to strive, why do you cling to the earth? أرضيتم بالحياة الدنيا من الآخرة. Have you become complacent and accepted this dunya at the expense of the hereafter? Is that how it is? You cling to the affairs of this dunya, and acts of worship become so difficult. Salah becomes so difficult. Fasting becomes so difficult. Charity, giving a donation, becomes so difficult. Helping your brother move to a new apartment becomes so difficult. Saying nice, loving, compassionate words becomes so difficult. Being insightful becomes difficult. Treating people with empathy becomes so difficult. We'd rather just waste time on vain conversations and watching movies and playing video games and wasting our existence looking at those screens. That's easy. But real effort to improve myself and to improve my family and my society and my heart, it becomes such a heavy burden. I pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to show us evil as clear as the light of day and to enable us and to empower us and equip us with the methods to overcome it. Allahumma ameen. Brothers and sisters, pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, raise your hands. ادعوا الله وانتم موقنون بالإجابة. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعين به ونستهديه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا وسيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله فهو المهتد ومن يضلل فلن تجد له وليا مرشدا. وأصلي وأسلم على المبعوث رحمة للعالمين وقائد الغر الميامين محمد الصادق الوعد الأمين. اللهم صلي وسلم وبارك عليه وعلى الصحابة والتابعين ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. وارض عنا معهم بفضلك وكرمك ارحم الراحمين اللهم امين. Reminding myself and all of you brothers and sisters today in our journey to prepare for Ramadan is to gauge the state of our faith and the state of our hearts, get a little bit ready. So that Ramadan becomes about enriching your heart as opposed to starting from scratch, which unfortunately happens to many of us. I talked to you about how to examine whether our hearts are weak or not, whether our faith is weak or not, and I gave you, you know, five-point advice on that. And obviously, today's advice will be incomplete if I do not share with you practical steps as to how to get there. How do I make sure that at least I'm on the right track in terms of nourishing my heart and rejuvenating my iman? Here's, again, some advice from the tradition, but I wanted to start with something that is just common sense. It is not fancy, it is not sophisticated, it's just simple common sense, okay? You need to understand how short this dunya is. And you need to ask yourself, what is it that I'm spending most of my time doing? How am I investing my time? As a young person, middle school, high school, college, whatever, if you're not married and you don't have a career, you don't have a family yet, you don't have a job, you don't have all these obligations, ask yourself, I'm a human being. I've been on this earth 7, 8, 9, 13, 15 years, whatever it is. How have I spent those years? I was, a baby for 3 or 4 years, that doesn't count. 6, 7 years, okay, I'm just a kid, I'm having fun. Okay, but now you're 10, you're 11, you're 17. How are you spending your existence? Do you think that you don't matter to Allah? Just because you're young, you don't matter to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Do you think that you don't have a function in this world, a purpose in this world, just because you're young? Absolutely not. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted us to assume responsibility at adulthood, He would have created us into adults right away. You're born, half an hour later, you're 20. He's not capable of doing that. Growth spurs. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can do that, but He doesn't do that. He prefers to see that gradual. Because you, at this age, mean something to Allah, and you have a purpose to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And He wants to see you thrive. And He wants to see you do beautiful things. Abdullah ibn Abbas, the Prophet's cousin, started his process of scholarship at the age of 6. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to talk to him as if he was an adult. Yes, you have fun and you enjoy for sure. All the halal things are available. But think of your purpose. This life is very short. Adult! What is the percentage of your time that you spend on making money versus the percentage that you spend on enriching your heart? That's a dangerous question. Is it 100% to zero? Work, 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 and that's it? And whatever time left you sleep or eat or perhaps even spend a minute with family and that's it? What about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Is it 75-25? I say today that the least we can do in terms of using our time is to make it 50-50. 50 on material things and 50% on the heart. The things that actually matter. I don't know if you heard this statement before. Imam Abu Hamid Ghazali, in his very popular book, Ayyuha al-Walad, it's basically a collection of letters that he sent to one of his students. Ayyuha al-Walad, my son. Letters that he sent to his student. In one of the statements he says, عِشْ مَا شِئْتَ فَإِنَّكَ مَيِّتَ. Live for as long as you may live, you will eventually die. Right? Everyone agrees to that. I hope this is not news to you. عِشْ مَا شِئْتَ فَإِنَّكَ مَيِّتَ. Live for as long as you may, One day you will have to leave this world.
وَأَحْبِبْ مَنْ شِئْتَ فَإِنَّكَ مُفَارِقُهُ.
Love whoever you may love. You will eventually have to leave them, either by their death or yours.
وَأَعْمَلْ مَا شِئْتَ فَإِنَّكَ مَجْزِيٌّ بِهِ.
Do whatever you may do. You have the choice. You have the freedom to do anything you would like to do in this dunya. But know that you will be brought to account for it on the Day of Judgment. When you know that you need to pray 5 times every day, and we keep saying, مَنْ شَبَّ عَلَى شَيْءٍ شَابَ عَلَيْهِ. If you get used to not praying when you're young, you are likely to not pray when you're older. When you keep saying, start praying as early as possible in your life, and you keep ignoring and ignoring and ignoring, until all of a sudden you're 13, and now you're accountable, and guess what? You're still not praying. And every second that passes, now it is held against you. And it goes into your record. Oh, Imam, I'm just 13.
Oh, really?
Nice try. We've told you 10 years ago, start praying. 50-year-olds, 60-year-olds who have been blessed with family and children and a job and a house, and Allah sends them a warning after a warning after a warning, and they're still not praying. Life is very short. How long do you think you're going to live? Invest in the real things that make sense, that will make your heart thrive. I don't know if you read this. Harvard just published a study. Believe it or not, they've been working on that study for 75 years. Don't tell me how. Those crazy PhD students and researchers. 75 years, and a generation hands over the study to the next generation. Until finally they're ready to publish the study. It's a study about happiness. What is the one single most important thing that makes us happy? They say relationships. Thriving, strong relationships. With family, with friends, with your loved ones, with people that you actually care about. And, in my judgment, as a man of faith, most importantly, the one relationship that counts, and that is between us and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What are we doing investing in that relationship? You want your iman to get stronger? Realize and understand that life is short and you need to invest in relationships. You need to spend more time in those relationships. If you are young, you need to spend more time asking yourself, what would make my parents happy? What would make my siblings happy? How can I become a better person in my family? And if you're an adult, ask yourself, what can I do to invest in the relationships that matter? Because it's not your nice, fancy leather jacket that will make you happy. It's not upgrading your car that will make you happy, I guarantee it. You are going to drive that car 3 or 4 times, and you're going to leave it there. You know how much of our time we drive our cars? Cars are only used 5% of their half-life. So if a car is made in 1975, and by 2020 it becomes a piece of junk, you know how much time it was used? Only 5%. Think about it. How often do you use the car? You drive the car, what, 15, 20 minutes, and then you park. Some of you commute a little bit longer, I understand that. But most of us, you drive the car and you leave it, and you go to work 6-7 hours, and then you drive the car home, and then you a couple hours, and then you go do shopping. It all takes a few minutes. 5% of the half-life of a car is used. Upgrading your car is not what is going to make you happy. It is your relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and people around you. That is number one. Number two, in terms of those practical steps, remember the moment of death. Young and old, trust me. We live in an age where 7-year-olds are dying with cancer. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect you and preserve you and your loved ones. This day and age, living in this country, now it is just not a matter of age anymore. Read more about death. Not to get yourself depressed, but to be prepared. Understand what it means. Whenever someone is going to the graveyard, or there's a funeral service or janazah or something, like, be a part of it. I have seen a 10-year-old, when I was at one of the funeral services, go into the grave and was preparing the grave for the body. I was like, wallahi, good for you. It's good for your soul. Don't treat death as a scary matter. Treat death as a reality. Just be prepared and be happy. If
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chooses me by His side, it'll be the greatest day of my life. Not that I desire to leave the world. I will live here because that is God's choice. But if it's my time to go, it's my time to go, and there's nothing I can do about it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran to remind us of that moment.
كَلَّا إِذَا بَلَغَتِ التَّرَاقِي وَقِيلَ مَنْ رَاقَ
In Surah Al-Qiyamah, speaking of the soul,
when the soul is being extracted out of your body and it gets right here, stuck in the throat, التَّرَاقِي You and people around you are so agonizing, and then you start screaming, مَنْ رَاقَ Who can help this person? Any doctors or magicians around? Any wise men that can help him? We can't do anything.
وَظَنَّ أَنَّهُ الْفِرَاقُ And when it gets stuck right here, that's when you realize this is it. This is it. I'm about to go.
وَظَنَّ أَنَّهُ الْفِرَاقُ وَالْتَفَّتِ السَّاقُ بِالسَّاقُ
The agony and the pain of death. Your legs will lock. You know, when people are moving their legs and their feet out of pain and agony, and they lock like this.
إِلَىٰ رَبِّكَ يَوْمَئِذٍ الْمَسَاقُ
The destiny now is to your Lord. No one can protect you anymore. Remembering that will inadvertently rejuvenate your iman, brothers and sisters.
Remember when you're standing before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, يَوْمَ الْعَرْضِ عَلَى الْجَبَّارِ
And you're asked about every word you've said, and every glance you've taken, and every action you've done. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala holds you to account. What will you say? Ya Allah, I was only 14 years old. He will slap you in the face and he'll tell you, no, you are an adult. And you are accountable and you are responsible. Don't give me that. Ya Allah, I was busy with work. I'm sorry. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not accept such excuses. Ask yourself,
يَوْمَ تَجِدُ كُلُّ نَفْسٍ مَّا عَمِلَتْ مِنْ خَيْرٍ مُحْضَرًا
On that day, every soul will see the good that it has done presented to it. And alhamdulillah, I had forgotten about that. Oh, thank God I did this. Thank God when my parents said pray, I actually prayed. Thank God I fasted that Ramadan.
Yeah, alhamdulillah, you're going to be looking for any opportunity. Thank God when my friends at school invited me to do this thing and I said, no, I can't, I'm Muslim.
Alhamdulillah. Now I'm so grateful. When you stand, muhdara, all the good things will be brought forth and you'll be able to see them.
وَمَا عَمِلَتْ مِنْ سُوءٍ تَوَدُّ لَوْ أَنَّ بَيْنَهَا وَبَيْنَهُ أَمَدًا بَعِيدًا
And all the bad things that you've done, you will wish that they're so far from you, miles away from you.
I did this.
And you would wish that you're miles away from those deeds. Last but not least, brothers and sisters, get involved in the community and surround yourselves with good people that will remind you of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It may be easier to be amongst friends who don't judge you, accept you for who you are, because that is the dangerous culture that we've created. People don't want to give advice to each other anymore because, hey, you can't judge me. That's the new definition of friendship. Let your friends fall into sin and hurt themselves. Don't judge. Hey, accept me for who I am. What kind of friendship is that? That's disgusting to me. Good friends will have the courage to look each other in the eye and say, this is wrong. And if I didn't care about you, I wouldn't have said anything. If you truly care about something, you need to help them stop. And hold their hands. Even if they get mad at you, even if they yell at you, they will appreciate you later. Surround yourself with honest and loving people, good people that will remind you. اصبر نفسك مع الذين يدعون ربهم. Be patient and stick with them. You will hear a good reminder, a good khatira, a good khutba, a good Quranic verse. Someone will say something, you will care. I'm coming to the masjid tomorrow and I will meet my friends. I don't want to do something bad that I can't face them. See, so many ways to protect yourself from sin if you are surrounded by good and positive and loving and compassionate people with good, strong iman. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to get us prepared in the most beautiful way for the month of Ramadan. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept our good deeds, to forgive us our sins, to allay our fears. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to be there for us when we need His help in our times of difficulty and times of crises. I ask Allah to forgive us for the hurt that we have done to others, and I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive us for the transgressions that we have committed against ourselves. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this month of Rajab to give us the strength to prepare and to get ready for the month of Ramadan. And I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make the month of Ramadan a month of forgiveness, healing and salvation for all of us. Allahumma ameen. اللهم لك الحمد كما ينبغي لجلال وجهك عظيم سلطانك صل على محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا تقبل منا يا ربنا إنك أنت السميع العليم وتب علينا إنك أنت التواب الرحيم اللهم اغفر لنا واجعلنا هداة مهديين لا ضالين ولا مضلين اللهم بلغنا رمضان واغفر لنا فيه يا أرحم الراحمين اللهم اغفر للمؤمنين والمؤمنات للمسلمين والمسلمات الأحياء منهم والأموات إنك سميع قريب مجيب الدعوات يا رب العالمين وأقم الصلاة إن الصلاة كانت على المؤمنين كتابا موقوتا